The views and opinions of this broadcast do not reflect the views and opinions of Armed Media, UNU Productions and its affiliates. Enjoy the show.
Live from Boston, Massachusetts, it's Les Skymo and The Dave on Unscheduled on Armed Radio. Folks, I want to thank our military, men and women scattered all around the globe and those out on the border and their families. Thank each and every one of them. Folks, keep them in your thoughts and your prayers. And we have a 1-800 number, 1-800-508-5431. And a week has gone by already, Dave. And so here we are on the silver or platinum microphones. And I look good, man. And I tell you what, I watched this hearing today. President Trump's over there in Vietnam. And I'm very optimistic about this summit over in Vietnam. Probably more optimistic than most about it. And I watched this clown show today, and this Cohen up there, which, you know, none of this should have come about to start with, Dave, because this whole thing was started from a lie, from that dossier. And, you know, if the right people come along to prosecute or to investigate this whole situation, all these people that's been convicted, even Cohen, now all that should be overturned because it was all perpetrated on false pretenses. And Cohen would have never been in front of Congress to lie to him in the first place if it wasn't for that dossier, if it wasn't for the Democrats. And you know, I tell you, they're vicious people, buddy. They're at all costs, brother. At all costs. And I watched these hearings today, and every time a Democrat would come on, I'd mute it, and I know what they're going to say. I don't want to hear nothing from them devils. You know, I've heard their propaganda before. And so I listened to it for a while. Republican come on, I'd unmute it. And so they tore him a new one, just like I thought they would. And so I got, a couple of hours, let it warm up a little bit outside, went outside, started fooling with my son's Jeep. And but I tell you what, they intentionally done this to knock that summit off television. Because they have no soul. They sold their what soul they had to the devil, and they have no there's nothing to them but just pure evil. And but now, not a whole lot coming out of Vietnam right now. I don't know how long this summit's supposed to last. And but now I tell you what. I said this the other day when I made a promo video on Facebook. And this is way out there, Dave. I'm not afraid to climb way out the end of the limb. But now I look for, this is my prediction. I'm good at that. Sometimes I'm hit and sometimes I miss. But I think these hearings, they're just going to come to nothing. Now you got the, prosecutors in New York, South Side New York there. They're going to be digging up everything that they can find on Donald Trump and everybody and their brother. They'll go back to when he started receiving lunch money. And but I think all this is going to come to naught, Dave. And I believe that it's going to backfire on the Democrats. I could be all wrong, folks, but this is just how my gut feeling on things, how I feel about things. And I honestly look for President Trump to get everything that we have to get out of Kim Jong-un over there. And I honestly look for President Trump to end the Korean War. My prediction is he's going to end the Korean War. Kim Jong-un will give up his nukes. And you want to know why I think this? Twice, President Trump has drawn him, however you want to say it. President Trump drew him out of North Korea, out into prosperous countries, South Korea, and now Vietnam. Now, both communist countries, okay, but they have private enterprise. The people are freer than they are in North Korea, but they do have the ability to own their own business and profit from it. Vietnam economy is booming. So Kim Jong-un is seeing all this, Dave. He's seeing all this prosperity. And I heard the other day the Secret Service man, I don't know if I said this last week or not, said that he had made the statement to somebody, Kim Jong-un did, that he didn't want to raise his children up with nuclear weapons. But Trump has drew him out and so he can look at prosperity. He can see it happening. He can see how happy the people are. The people love Donald Trump over there in Vietnam. Everywhere in the world they love Donald Trump, except here in America. So I think he's going to pull it off. I think he's going to sign a peace treaty with North Korea, Dave.
Well, if he signs it, though, the thing is, you know, what they may demand if in order to sign is to remove the 20-some thousand U.S. troops from South Korea. Because, let's face it, if the war's over, there's no reason to keep U.S. troops there.
That's true. But so, then
that may be a trap.
Well, he's not going to do it. This will be a process. He won't do it right away. He'll draw them down. And then, you know, Kim Jong-un cannot be trusted. Okay. He'll have to be monitored. We'll have to have a liaison office in North Korea to monitor the teardown of the nuclear weapons and the nuclear sites. So it's going to be a long, drawn-out process. We'll leave troops there to monitor the situation, you know, and it's going to take a while, but I think President Trump is going to pull it off, and I also think he's going to be reelected. That's my other prediction. So, you know,
it's a funny thing to see, though. Being an old-time vet, I was Vietnam War veteran, but I wasn't in country, but I was over here. But during that time, it's funny to see Air Force One land in Hanoi. I mean, the last time I saw anything over Hanoi was B-52 bombers bombing Hanoi.
Right.
And it only goes to show you who's our enemy today may be our friends tomorrow, and vice versa. Who's our friend today may be our enemy tomorrow. But when I was in the Air Force, we did flight physicals on Iranian and Iraqi Air Force pilots. And because both countries flew U.S. aircraft.
Well, we had them at Fort Benning, Georgia.
They were 70, our buddies back then.
Yeah, in 76.
How things have changed.
77.
But I think we should let well enough alone, you know, because we never would have messed with Saddam Hussein. Just think where the world would be right now.
Mm-hmm.
Syria, the whole thing in Syria wouldn't have happened. The balance of power would be between Iraq and Iran would have been Iraq, Saddam Hussein would have held them at bay. They wouldn't be causing trouble throughout the Middle East as they are right now. So you got to be careful what you stir up because it can come back to bite you.
Well, you know, once they declared him a war criminal, that's the word. Once they declared him a war criminal, him and his regime, you know, they had to go after them. But see, we get ourselves in trouble, Dave. Over and over, out through history, we have done this. Okay, when we when we provide arms and military for a lot of our, say, rebels or other countries. You know, we'll the war break out, they'll ally with us. We'll pump arms and money and resources and military into that country. Okay, then when everything's all said and done, hey man, they've got a big military. They've got all kinds of weapons. We don't take that stuff back. We leave it with them. Then the next thing you know, we're going to war with them, Dave. Over our history, there've been a lot of military men and women killed with our own weapons.
But the thing about it is, if you look at what's in our national interest, sometimes it's not in our national interest to go and fight in the Middle East. It was with Hitler, because he threatened the world, because our friends were the
Japan, same way.
Was Great Britain, and if it hadn't been Pearl Harbor, we probably wouldn't have got into the war when we did. We probably would have took much later. But the thing is, our national interests have to be paid attention to, because we can't keep going in and fighting these wars. They're too expensive, and his loss of life is too great. Like we've been in Afghanistan now for 17 years, 18 years.
17 years, I think.
That's, you know, that's just such a long time.
Oh yeah. That,
and the, you know what happened with the Russians over there? They had to get out, and I think that's eventually what's going to happen to us, because we're just going to have to get out. We can't stay there forever.
Well, Dave, and I tell you, we get into this mission creep, is exactly what it is. And, you know, World War II, we got involved in World War I, and then again with Germany in World War II. And, you know, we rebuilt England. You know, we rebuilt France, and, Poland, we reached out to Poland and done a lot for them. They love us over there. And, but, you know, when you get into this nation-building stuff, what we done to Japan, now, of course, we wound up paying pensions to those that were still alive with Hiroshima and Nagasaki. But after that devastation of them atomic bombs, it done something to the psyche of these our commanders and up at the Pentagon. And along come Korea. Okay, we pussyfooted around in North Korea when that war started. Chinese was pumping arms and humans, soldiers in to North Korea, pumping weapons into North Korea. Okay, and we tried to fight that war different. You know, we didn't want to have the devastation over. We didn't want to destroy the country like we did Japan. If we had of, we wouldn't be dealing with Kim Jong-un today.
But look what.
But they were scared of China. It's always China, and I get sick of hearing that.
Think about this for a second. What would have happened if we never went into Korea? What would have happened if we never went into the Middle East to begin with, when H.W. Bush went into Kuwait and kicked the Iraqis out of Kuwait? What if we'd left things as they were? Mm-hmm. What would have been the end result? I can't see the world changing that much. What if we never went into Vietnam? It'd be just like it is today.
Well, you know why we went in? I'll tell you exactly why we went in there.
But we lost 58,000 lives in Vietnam. And look, it ended up...
We went in there because they asked us to, because they were slaughtering innocent people. The communists were pillaging their villages, killing... Raping,
but the thing
robbing
is,
innocent
that's,
people. That's why we went.
That wasn't our national interest to do it.
apparently
that happens. All that's going on all over the world right now.
I understand that.
It's going on in Africa. Yeah. It's going on in the Middle East. It's going on in Somalia.
But this all goes back to the Revolutionary War, Dave. When France come and helped us, that wasn't in their national interest. Well, okay, but that's where all this started, and then they just carried it on, And, you know, when they're, but on the other hand, Dave, you look at the genocide that's going on in Africa. We haven't stepped in there and stopped that. You look at the Somalian pirates that's robbing these ships, holding them for hostages and stuff. You've seen what happened to our sailors there. I mean, you know, we do make some bad decisions, and
but the thing between,
you know, and I agree with you. Now, I agree with you to a big degree, Dave. Yeah.
But we can't be the world's policemen. But the thing between, take Japan and Germany in World War II, we both went in and rebuilt. I mean, we went in and rebuilt the countries.
Yeah,
basically, we
right.
had the Marshall Plan, went in back into Germany and Europe and rebuilt the country, all the countries. But the big difference is in the Middle East, is the big difference is Islam.
Right.
Islam is
right.
The big difference. Now, you
exactly.
have different religions in Japan, and they really aren't gung-ho on it. But these people will cut your head off if you don't believe in Allah.
Well, and that's
a big difference.
It's an ideology, Dave. It's not a religion. It's an ideology, okay? And it's either convert or die. A religion of any sort, or no other religion that does that.
Religion demands servitude.
Yeah.
That means you have to obey the rules of that religion. And if you don't do it, then you're not part of the religion. This is where we're at right now. You cannot change these people. You can't bring democracy to these countries that are Islamic countries. It's not their cup of tea.
They don't want to be like us.
They don't want to have democracy.
Right.
They want to have Sharia law. They don't want to have democracy. They don't want to have law. And if you notice where they go, they take their society with them. They take their culture with them.
And
whether it's England, France, it doesn't matter.
United States, they pile up in the streets up there in New York City right now, so stop traffic on prayer time to do all the
with
prayer.
With that in mind, keep that in mind, what are we going to do in Afghanistan and Iraq? What are we going to do?
Nothing.
How are we ever going to solve that problem? I mean, those people have been fighting for thousands, over 1,000 years.
See, and that's why I think, David, it's different than communism. Okay, people that's under communism, they want to be free. People under Islamic law, okay, the general public, they don't want to be like us. They want to live that way. Okay, now, they say, well, we're not extremists. We don't believe in cutting heads off. We don't believe in Sharia law and stuff like that. But now, if you read the Quran, you believe the Quran, how can you not believe that? You know, and some people say, well, that Sharia law was an add-on. That come along later. Okay, but see, from the get-go, one thing that Islam mandates is you take it over. You conquer. And that's their goal. You know, to get into your politics, get into your communities, and eventually they're going to control you.
See, that's what they say. They say once when they hold a country in control, when they take over a country, that it always should remain Islamic.
Well, see,
that's why Israel is a problem for them, because at one time the Palestinians had control of the country.
Yes.
The Israelis didn't. The Jews didn't have control. That's why they want it back. They do not want peace in the middle in Israel. I'll tell you why. PLO started under Yasser Arafat back in the early 1960s.
Sixties, I remember.
And what happened was he was an Egyptian. He wasn't from there. He's an Egyptian. So what does he do? He goes in there and stirs up trouble. He says they just want a piece of land and everything would be cool. Well, look, they got the Gaza Strip. Look what happened. After they got it. Now,
next day they start sending rockets over.
It's not land for peace. It's land for missiles.
Right.
And that's exactly what they're going to do if they give them any more land. And the Israelis aren't stupid. They say, we give them land, that's just another place we have to go in or defend against missile launches.
Right.
And you already got Lebanon to the north with Hezbollah. You got Hamas in the Gaza Strip. You got the Iranians over there. So you got all these different factions, all these different ideas. You got the Iranians who are Shia Muslims. They're not Sunni Muslims. They're the minority. Only about 10 or 15% of all Muslims are Shia Muslims. So there you got another faction. And you got Syria, which is about half and half. Iraq to the north is mostly Shia Muslims, along with Kurds. But the Sunnis to the south, and Saddam kept all that stuff in check when he was in control of the country. He kept it in check. It's out of control now.
Oh, yeah.
And if we think we're going to solve that problem over there, we never will.
Right.
Because it's a pipe dream.
Right. Well, and you know why we went into the Middle East over Afghanistan, Iraq, and it was over 9/11. And, you know, we was fighting the Taliban, and the Taliban turned into ISIS. And, you know, there's widespread. And, you know, they've even... A sect of them over there in Africa. I forget what you call them, but they're the same thing. They're Muslims and extremists. And you're right, Dave. When we went over there, okay, something had to be done. When them towers got bombed, something had to be done. But from my standpoint, where we went wrong is we didn't obliterate. Is that the word? Annihilate the place.
You can't.
We should have just.
The thing is, though, Les, you can't kill everybody.
You can't kill everybody.
You can't kill your way out of this problem.
But that's
because
true.
Because you'd have to take. You'd have to do Syria, Iraq, Iran, the Saudis, Lebanon, North Africa, Morocco. You'd have to do all those countries. Libya. You have to do Egypt. You have to. Somalia, all the place where Islam thrives, Indonesia, Malaysia, you have to kill them all.
And well,
you
can't.
There's like 1.7 billion of these
right.
people.
Oh,
that's
right.
A lot of people. Yeah. That's probably, about a fourth of the right. population
but
of the world?
But they're not all...
One out of four people is a Muslim.
But they're not all the same, just like me and you are not all the same.
But that's where the problem is.
What would you suggest... After they,
I think Trump gets it myself. Trump gets it.
Well, I understand that. But
he wanted to get out of Syria.
Right.
He's going to leave, 400 troops there or whatever?
200, I think, 400. I agree with that.
What's that going to be, a tripwire in case they go back and reconstitute ISIS? As a tripwire, yeah, maybe. But the thing is, you're never going to defeat. As soon as we leave or as soon as they get an open area, they're going to reconstitute.
Well, as long as there's Muslims alive, that's going to happen.
I mean, that's just their nature. That's
exactly.
what they do. They'd rather terrorize as to eat when they're hungry.
But what should we have done on 9/11?
We did it. We went in there with the bombers. We bombed them. We took out most of their facilities. Then we had special forces go in. They took care of. Remember, they was riding the horses and they took over. Well, they took over and they got rid of them the best they could, and then we should just get out.
I agree with
and
that.
Yeah. If they pop up
I've
again,
got no problem.
If they pop
with
up again, bomb them.
I agree.
Don't put troops over
but
there.
See, we got in there and thought we were going to get them, instead of growing opium, get them growing corn and tomatoes.
I'll tell you, Les, how I've changed on this issue. I'll tell you how I've changed on this issue.
But
back in 1991, when George H.W. Bush went into Kuwait, remember they had everybody lined up in Saudi Arabia.
Yeah.
They had them all lined up and ready to go in. 500,000 troops, tanks, everything, bombing and everything, ready to go into Kuwait. Back then, I thought, well, he should just go on and take out Baghdad. Bad idea. He was right. He was absolutely right to stop when he did and left Saddam intact because... If he'd done that, we'd been in worse shape than we are now. And his son should have never took on Iraq. They had nothing to do with the Twin Towers. Those were mostly Saudis. I think, 16 of them were Saudis? The rest of them were a couple of Egyptians and Syrians, maybe. But they weren't any Iraqis
right.
at all. Saddam Hussein had nothing to do with that.
Yeah, but that ain't what they thought. Go in there. Kill a bunch of them off and come home. I agree with that. Because, like you said, they're Muslim. They don't want to be Americans. Now they want to come over here and leech everything they can off of us And they would love to get into our Congress enough and into our cities, become mayors and councilmen and take it over. That's what they're all about. That's their whole agenda, is to conquer.
That's probably what they've done already in Europe.
Well, look at the shape it's in. France right now is still burning. You know, on the weekends over there in London, man, there are riots at Tommy Robinson and stuff. He's one of them that's heading that stuff up, man. And but you know, you're exactly right. Yeah,
I just don't see any good ending for all this that's going on right now.
Well, you know, it.
But when a strong man pops up over there and can bring peace to that whole area, the people's going to follow him.
Well, sure.
And we all know who that guy is going to be.
Right.
And what he's going to do and how he's going to do it.
Right.
Because they will. I think I heard a quote from some Israelis said, we'd follow the devil himself if they could bring peace.
Right. I've heard that statement before.
And, that's exactly what's going to happen.
Oh, yeah.
For a while.
But now, it is what it is. And seeing that's another reason why President Trump's got to stay in office, man. I mean, if he's a man of God, if God put him in office, this stuff's all going to blow over. It's all going to pan out. Now, that ain't to say that he ain't going to have to fight him the whole way, the whole six more years.
Well, I think Trump's got the right idea, though, as far as foreign policy goes. I think he's going on the right track. And I think he's different than a typical Republican would
be. Well, see, he has nothing to do with the war machine, with the military complex, you know.
Industrial
complex.
Military complex.
Yeah, you know. And
that's what Eisenhower warned us about, and he was right.
Yeah, you know. And there's billions of dollars in war, Dave, you know. And but now enough's enough.
But now it's spread out to where you got congressmen not wanting to spend the $3 or $4 million in the emergency plan because they think it might affect some base in one of their states.
Oh yeah, politics.
You know, that's crazy.
Right.
The military budget's over $700 billion, and they can't spare $3 or $4 billion.
Right.
From the military budget.
Right.
I think that's ridiculous.
Well, it's just like this fight over the wall. Okay, President Trump wants $5 billion, okay, and now the Republicans, I've got this right here, man, they passed a resolution and to stop the emergency, national emergency that he declared on the border, and so they, it passed in the House. And 13 Republicans who voted with the Democrats to end the national emergency. There's 13 of them right there now.
That doesn't surprise me. Justin Amash,
read them
Brian
off,
Fitzpatrick,
Dave.
Mike Gallagher, Jamie Herrera Butler,
state
Will
from?
Hurd from Texas. He's right on the border area down in Texas.
Yeah.
Dusty Johnson, Thomas Massey. I'm kind of surprised about him. He's from Kentucky. And Kathy McMorris Rogers from Washington State. Francis Rooney, Jim Sensenbrenner, Elsie Stefanik, Fred Upton, and Greg Walden from Oregon. It doesn't surprise me on some of those names.
But now, why would they do that? If they're not, you know, some of these.
But you know, Les, this is why. This
these
is what,
are, some of them are never Trumpers. That's
now,
why
now,
they did this.
But this gets me, though. Well, this surprises me. The
13 of them, they got to go, Dave.
Thomas Massey, I think Trump campaigned for him. Didn't he fly down to Kentucky and campaign for him?
I do believe
for
he
re-election?
Did.
I think he did.
But it seems to me like he needs to go.
That's kind of surprising. Will Hurd, not so much, because he's right on the. Most of his constituencies are Hispanic. He's right on the border there with Mexico. Roughly all these representatives, each one of them represent about 750,000 people.
Right.
So I can see why some of their people wouldn't want, you know, the money spent because they might be in liberal areas or blue, purple areas or whatever. But the thing about it is, none of these guys, if it came down to their own personal decision, would object.
Right.
It's just what they think their constituencies want.
It's politics, bro.
Yeah, it's politics.
Whatever happened to the day of laying your job on the line to do what's right? Folks out there in radio land and under the sound of my voice, These representatives right here, if any of them are your representatives, find somebody to replace these dirty rats. Because here's the thing, David, this ain't the end of them. If they're going to do this over a legitimate cause, if they're going to do this to President Trump, they're going to be obstructionists on down the road. These people need to be replaced. They need to be thrown out of the House. And right along with Nancy Pelosi and a bunch of them, there is no excuse for this, Dave.
Just think about this, though. We had, in this past election, we had, I think it was 40-some Republicans they retired because they could not maintain their seat.
Yeah.
As far as the chairmanships.
Yeah.
So what do? They retire. And that's why we lost the House.
Exactly.
We lost 40-some seats because they had a newbie come up to battle, and nobody knew who they were.
They took their ball and went home.
Nobody knew who they were. So what happened, we put an even playing field between the incumbent and a challenger.
A newbie.
Right. So we lost the House, but I mean that's going to happen over and over again because we have term limits. Democrats don't.
Right. Yeah. Well, see, here's another thing too.
In that respect.
Over and over now. Okay. Well, I'm starting to see, and I have been for the past couple 3 months. The illegal votes. They're finding the illegal votes now, and some of them are up into the hundreds in some of these states. Mm-hmm. And we know that this is what this is all about. But I'll tell you what, these 13 representatives here, folks, find out who your representative is, and if they voted with the Democrats on this, do whatever you can, campaign against them, find somebody that will run and against these people, because this is just, it's ridiculous, Dave. Now,
the thing about it, Lester, is that on this border wall issue, there's no way that we can have that wall unless people vote for the money to get it. I mean, and the thing is that all these people say, well, if we do this thing, the Democrats are going to come along in the future with a Democrat president, and they're going to say, well, we want to do the Green Deal. And we want to cause a national emergency. Well, they can do it anyway. I got news for them.
Yeah.
So if Trump gets this through, it doesn't affect what the future is because that law is still in existence. All they can do is there's nothing to stop a Democrat in the future from doing it.
Right.
So that's not the problem. But when they say, well, we don't want a Democrat president to come along in the future and do the same thing with the Green New Deal or whatever, say gun control.
Guns, yeah.
They can do that. Well, they can do it anyway.
Right.
So what difference does it make if Trump gets this through?
As long as that law is there, David, it makes no difference. The Congress gives the president, this ability to do this.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now, if that would have been a Democrat president, if he would have done it, for any reason, don't matter, send bottled water to the moon, they would have not acted this way. Every Democrat in the House would have voted for it. Don't make no difference what it is. But these 13 Republicans are dirty scoundrels. They should have never done that. And you mark my words, they're going to be trouble in the future. Now, I don't, I'm sure they didn't all come in at the same time. I don't know when they're come up for election, but now, folks, they got to go.
McMorris Rogers used to be in leadership. She was in the last Congress.
Was she? Yeah.
And then
chairman or something.
She was like one of the higher ups in the Republican caucus. I don't know what her position was, but she represents the Spokane, Washington area. I know that.
And
that's a pretty conservative area out that part of Washington. It doesn't get radical until you go over the mountains to Seattle and on down the coast. That's where the really, you know, liberal area is.
Right. Now,
aggressive.
See, this goes on to the Senate now. Well, I think today they're supposed to vote on this in the Senate. Today or tonight. They may postpone it to tomorrow now. Okay, but watch and see. Just like these 13, watch these Republicans and see which, if there's any of the dirty rats that cross over, okay, and vote with the Democrats on it to overturn the national emergency on this. However, Trump, you know good and well, Trump's going to veto it. He done told them, you know, that I'm going to veto it. They have to have 60 votes to override that veto, okay? And so, or what is it, two-thirds? You got to have two-thirds of the House to over, or the Senate to override the veto. They're not going to get that. For sure, the Republicans will stand
together.
That'd
be 66 or 67 senators would have to vote against it. And that, I don't think that's going to happen.
Yeah, it's two-thirds, yeah. But watch it, folks. Watch and see if any of the Republicans vote with the Democrats when this gets to the Senate. But this just burns me up.
Trump will veto it, and it probably won't be overridden, I don't think.
I don't think it'll be overridden. They're going to sue him, and it's going to wind up at the Supreme Court, which it will be upheld at the Supreme Court.
See, I don't understand why the Republicans think this way, because the Democrats can... They can do their thing anyway when they get a Democrat president in. There's nothing to stop them.
Right, exactly.
It's not like that we're setting some unusual precedent here.
Right.
States of emergency have been declared since Jimmy Carter.
Oh, yeah.
Since the early, late 1970s.
What, 30-something still in effect right now?
Yeah, some of them is still in effect right now.
29,
I don't know how many.
26.
But there's some of them is pretty dumb, really.
Yeah, you know. And but, you know, getting back to this... summit over there with President Trump, Kim Jong-un. Here's something that dawned on me, and I heard some people talking about it today. Sooner or later, and it won't be, I don't think it'll be today, and we're in this summit. I don't think it'll be in this summit. But somewhere, David, in the near future, President Trump will bring up Otto Warmbier. And, you know, his human rights record is going to have to be an issue. But now I think President Trump will address it with him. Mm-hmm. I don't know what we can expect to get out of that. You know, what really did happen to him? Did Kim Jong-un order this? You know, everything the communist military does, you know, yeah. They do it their own will, you know. Now, did they do this and Kim Jong-un not know about it until it was done, or, I mean, there's a lot of mystery surrounding this.
See, you got a certain amount of, it's a weird country, North Korea. They have, the military has autonomy. And it's not like the United States, where a civilian president controls the military.
Everything.
It's not like that in North Korea. Military, they have a certain amount of autonomy. They can do pretty much what they want to do.
Yeah.
And then they can take care of problems, and they have the authority to do it because it's basically the military that keeps Kim Jong-un in control of the country.
Oh, there's no doubt.
The same thing in Venezuela. When you got the generals, you got the country, because anybody that says anything will be shot.
You got the
army down there in Venezuela shooting people and not letting supplies in, you know, past Colombian border.
They're burning it.
And that's foolishness. But until those, I'll tell you a way to solve that, and it's probably being done right now, is President Trump ought to say, okay, you would take a bunch of bags of money down there via the CIA and give it to these generals and say, look, you get on our team, you leave this clown, and you'll get more money. And we won't, you know, we won't prosecute you, and you can keep your job. But just leave this clown. And that's exactly how it's done.
Oh, yeah, sure.
It's just giving them a bigger bribe than what they're getting from Maduro right now.
Right.
That's how you do that.
Yeah.
It's done every day. CIA, that's one of their jobs, is overthrowing governments like
that. Right, right. Yeah, that's what they was form to do was
you get a big suitcase full of $100 bills wadded up, I mean, stacks of hundreds.
Yeah.
You open that baby up and say, yeah. What you need? I'll help you out. You know, a $100 bill, you wouldn't believe how much you could buy down there with a $100 bill.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, you could buy practically anything.
Right. American money, too.
Yeah.
But, you know, I don't know. It's the world's a mess. But now, I really believe Donald Trump, like you said, I believe he gets it. And
I know he does. He gets it.
Yeah. Folks, it's Armed Radio, Les Skymo and The Dave, and we're also live streaming on Facebook. Any comments, questions, go ahead and shoot them to us. You can also call us on 1-800-508-5431 and, you know, give us a call. And I've got my, it's not a new phone, it's new to me. I finally give up my flip phone, Dave, and I'm still grieving over it. This smartphone, I'm not smart enough yet to operate it. I'm still fooling around with it. It's heavy. It's big. I don't like it. But now when I'm at the hunting camp or something, I can, after I get it all set up, I can do my show from it and whatever. And I can do Facebook Live. And I can do a lot of things on this I couldn't do on the old flip phone. But, boy, I tell you, the learning curve is, it's almost a circle at the learning curve is so big. Here's something else, too, now, Dave, that me and you are very passionate about. This Born Alive bill, where they want to murder these little babies, these botched abortions, and they're born alive. And the Republicans, they put up a bill to give these babies medical care. And by a 53-44 procedural vote, the Democrats, they stopped it. But there was Senator Bob Casey of Pennsylvania, Joe Manchin of West Virginia, and Doug Jones from Alabama joined the Republicans to advance the bill by voting yay on it. And it was stymied.
It didn't meet the 60 vote threshold.
Right, that's right. And
filibuster.
Yeah. Right. Couldn't get enough Democrats over to support it. And, you know, it was the Senate 311 bill, Senate 311 bill. But that's a crying shame, Dave. What have we come to here in this country when I say we, I shouldn't even say we, but when there's people in this country that's were just flat out murdering born babies, it's born alive.
Well, I got an idea for you. You tell me if you can answer this question.
Okay.
Why don't the Republicans just take and do away with the filibuster? They got the majority. Why don't they just make it a simple 51-seat majority, 51-vote majority?
Yeah.
Why don't they do that?
I don't know. And the Democrats done it a time or two to get what they wanted.
Well, think about this, Les. They said there's only 6 states where progressives or liberals outnumber Republicans or conservatives. 6 states. That, to me, sounds like we should have 44 U.S. senators that are conservative.
You'd think.
I mean, think about it. And if that's the case, we could control the Senate from here on out.
Yeah.
Forever, if we get good candidates.
Yeah.
If that's the case, if this poll was correct, there's only 6 states. I think it was Washington, Oregon, California, New York, Connecticut.
Probably Vermont.
Maybe Vermont. I'm not sure. But it was one of those northeastern states.
Maryland.
It could have been Maryland. But they out where conservatives are outnumbered by liberals. So if that's the case, and it's mostly red states and mostly red country, when you look on a map, it looks almost entirely red.
Yeah.
Why can't we control the Senate and just have a simple majority?
Because of Mitch McConnell. I tell you what, I was so against him being reelected when he got elected the last time. He's weak. He's got no backbone. He's spineless. He's corrupt. Washington runs on blackmail, David. Okay, and that's one thing about President Trump. They can't blackmail him. They don't know how to stop him other than lie on him in this dossier and what you see going on right now. The reason, and I say this until I'm proved wrong, that Jeff Sessions, they had something on him. He was a plant. he was being blackmailed. Our Congress is operated on blackmail. That's just how it is. But the 60 vote thing is not constitutional, Dave.
I know it.
That's a rule that they voted in theirself. Okay, and I don't know who was the first one to do it. Maybe I'm wrong, but I wouldn't doubt it been a Republican, because we want to get along with them. And that's, I tell you what, man, I could slap the taste out of some of them's mouth over go along to get along, and in the public, we wind up with killing babies. We wind up with gun control. We wind up with a 10-year-old transgressor little boys dancing in gay bars, and they're throwing dollar bills at him. We wind up with gay marriage. We wind up with all the perversion. Wind up with gay pride parades, and these idiot parents taking their children to this kind of nonsense.
That's because they don't know God.
Yeah, exactly.
That's the whole reason for that.
But now,
all the stuff you named is because they're lost.
It's unleashed humanism is what it is, human nature. But Dave, you know, everybody ain't like that. There are honest people that's not Christian people and that wouldn't put up with this stuff. However, you have a big swath of them that's give me Barabbas, and you know what that's a reference to. But you know, go back to the Republicans. Trump put more faith in these spineless Republicans, and not all of them, because you don't see it with McConnell. But you see people like Lindsey Graham, okay? You see people like Jim, whatever his name is here in Ohio, Jordan. They're stepping up to the plate, and they got some backbone to them. Lindsey Graham, before Donald Trump come along, he was just as weak as McConnell was, you know? And... So, I don't know.
He hung out with McCain a lot back then.
And he did. And, you know, I don't know about you, but I didn't care much for McCain either. But that's a dirty shame, David, that these poor babies, the killing continues. And this crap needs to be stopped. And you talk about the attacks on President Trump now. We got a staffer from the 2016 presidential campaign says that President Trump kissed her and it was unwanted. Okay, and then she comes up with all these witnesses, and then, okay, it's another Blousy Ford, whatever her name was. The people that she named as witnesses, they denied it. They said they didn't see it. And,
why did it take over 2 years for it to come out?
Well, it's because it's a bunch of horse hockey. For the same reason the rest of them, Dave. I immediately felt violated because I wasn't expecting it or wanting it, she said. And in a statement to White House, Sarah Saunders dismissed Johnson's, her name's last name's Johnson, the allegation as observed on its face. This never happened and is directly contradicted by multiple highly credible
eyewitness accounts. Does he have any video is what I want to know. I want to see some video on it.
No video has surfaced to this point.
All right. Well, no, I don't believe it.
So, you know.
Until I see the video, I'm not going to believe it.
Well, it's just like deja vu, man. You know, here we go again. And here's something now. You talk about the abortion issue, Dave, now. And we know about the undercover videos. Planned Parenthood, they denied this for a long time about selling body parts to these little kids. And on February 13th, you may have heard about this, these Ecuadorian brothers who were, they owned Da Vinci Biosciences and DV Biologics. And I think they owned them, they was affiliated with them. There were principals in these two companies anyway. And but anyway, they was ordered to be shut down for illegally trafficking worldwide baby parts that it obtained from Planned Parenthood. Now, these two brothers was arrested by ICE on February 13th this year. Hmm. So this is still yet to evolve. The arrest of Roberto and William Isaias was gratifying to Operation Rescue, which published an investigative report on October 27, 2016, when they blew the lid off of these baby parts, just days before presidential election to put President Trump in office. And it detailed their crimes in Ecuador, dubious dealings with the Obama administration for their business with Planned Parenthood, and the aborted baby body parts trade. Now, why are they still in operation, Dave? I can't figure this out to save my life. What is going on? You know, we know this is happening. What's going on, you know? Why hasn't this stuff, why haven't they been shut down?
Well, basically, news media, mainstream media, they go along with anything like that. They won't even publicize it for the most part. You'll never hear a word of it. And that's why they're able to get away with a lot of stuff, because nobody knows about it. We know about it because we're interested in it, but most people live their lives, they don't hear anything about that until it happens to them. Or
yeah.
It becomes part of their family or part of their life. But mainstream news media, they could not care less about what goes on as far as abortion goes. They never publicized any of that came out a year or two ago about the body parts trade, when they had them on video and they said it was doctored,
yeah,
but it wasn't. They had them on, had it recorded that, you know, they were making a deal for body parts.
Right.
It's as simple as that.
Yeah, that's at Operation Rescue, I think, in conjunction with Veritas, I think.
Yeah, it was Veritas.
Veritas, yeah. But it said right here, the ISIS family began dumping large amounts of campaign contributions into the American political campaigns, including $90,000 to the Obama's 2012 reelection campaign. As a result, after reaching out to Secretary of State Hillary Clinton for asylum, the Isaiases were granted expedited immigration into the United States. And the Clinton State Department, you know, they denied it. And it says here that they own these two companies. Once in America, the Isaias family owned and operated the Da Vinci Bioscience and the DV Biologics company that contracted exclusively with Planned Parenthood of Orange County to receive, that's California, to receive aborted baby tissues and organs, which they trafficked overseas. You know, and it's been widespread known for a long, long time, David, that there's a lot of money in these body parts of these little dead babies. And when you can lay them out on a table and they're viable, where they can live, and then they turn around and kill them. I mean, what do we come to, Dave, when we're doing that stuff?
I heard on the news that there's a record that this baby that was born premature, that weighed, I think, around 10 ounces, and survived and went home from the hospital. Think about that. That's less than a pound. And that's a record. But we have the technology anymore to keep kids alive that are born that small.
Right. Oh, yeah.
And, you know, the baby went home at from 10 ounces at birth to 7 pounds. So they let the baby go home.
And they live, they after a while, they catch up and they become functioning, normal, full-grown adults. You know,
they can survive for a short time without help outside the womb, but we have the technology now to keep them alive.
I think at 20 weeks, they've got fingerprints.
But see, that's what that governor, Northam, was saying. He said, well, I'll tell you exactly what's going to happen.
Yeah.
They'll have a discussion with the mother, and we'll see if we want to keep the baby comfortable or, you know, kill it.
Yeah.
That's the choice. And this thing about women's reproductive health, that gets to me. What is reproductive health when you're killing your baby?
Yeah, what's healthy about killing your baby?
It's not healthy at all.
And it ain't her body to start with.
Right. When the baby's born, there's no chance of it affecting the mother's life.
Yeah.
Because the baby's full term and is already born. So that's a lie right there when they say that it's all for the mother's health.
Right.
But that's not true because
the
baby is alive and well and at full term.
Right.
And they're killing it at full term.
Right.
That's called infanticide. That means killing a baby.
Murder.
And you can't go around killing a baby. You just can't do it.
Yeah. Well, Dave, we got our poke there, brother, and we probably got about 20 seconds here. I want to thank everybody out there on Armed Radio for listening in. Dave, thank you for doing what you're doing, and, you know, God bless everybody. We'll get into these other stories. We didn't get into everything. We never do, but, you know, we'll get into the rest of it next time, maybe. But anyway, this is Les Skymo and the Dave on Armed Radio. And God bless you, and we'll see you next week. And tune in same time, same channel. Take us out, Jimmy. Thank you, brother.
Evolution, revolution, gun control, sound, so shooting rockets to the moon, kids.